Hello, I'm Jesse, and this is the Funny Playing FPGBC. So let's put it together. The FPGBC is an FPGA-based reproduction of the Game Boy and Game Boy Color. If you know what the analog pocket is, it's kind of like that, built with a similar technology, except it's only made to run Game Boy and Game Boy Color games, not any of the other systems that the analog pocket supports. It's also a lot cheaper. The FPGBC comes as a kit, and you only get the main board, the screen, the battery, and a speaker. So if you want to assemble a full Game Boy Color, you need to also get a case, some button pads, and some buttons. And then you'll have everything you need. So the first thing we're going to do is to test everything to make sure it works. It says so, right on the package. First we'll plug in the screen. The screen connects with this ribbon cable to a connector on the front of the main board. It's kind of fiddly. And you have to be careful not to have any metal pieces touch any of the contacts, because that could short things out and break the product. Next, we'll put in the speaker. And finally, connect the battery. Now we can turn it on, see if it works. It does. Now we can take all that apart. First the battery, and the speaker. And finally, take the screen out. And get to assembling. So, the assembly, the first thing we need to do is put in buttons. I got these nice red ones. I hope they look good. Luckily, the buttons and the shell are made so that it's really easy to get everything in the right place. The A and B button have these little wings that are shaped differently, so you know you're going to get them in the right hole, and you know it's not going to be turned around wrong. There we go, and I'm going to put the power switch in now. And now we need to put the rubber pads. They attach to little plastic pins. They're nice and secured. And we'll start and select. Now we can put the main board into the case. Oh, no. First, we're going to want to put the speaker. Speaker comes with this little rubber ring that goes around, just helps keep it in place, I guess. I don't know. It's a bit fiddly. And the speaker also has these big globs on the sides. Can't get it to focus. Big globs on either side, so you have to kind of turn it so that it'll end up fitting with the main board. Looks good. Hopefully that'll be fine. Alright, now the main board, which goes on top. You can see the metal pads here. Those are the things that go on top of the rubber pads. And I find it a little bit tricky to get this positioned right, but eventually it gets in. I think. We'll figure that out. Now, some screws. There are two kinds of screws this comes with. Some short Phillips head screws, those are for the inside, and some longer Nintendo style tri-wing screws, those go on the outside. And on the inside, there's three places for the screws. There's here, here, and here in the middle. So I find it helpful to press down on the board while you're doing this to keep everything in place. And since you're screwing directly into plastic, you want to be a little bit careful. You don't want to screw it in too tight, because you don't want to break the plastic. Middle screw. You don't have to put this middle screw in. Some people recommend not putting it in because it can press against the back. Let's try having it in. The back has this little circular cutout right here to make room for that screw. There you go. So some people recommend not putting that screw in at all. Certainly not necessary. But I'm going to try putting it in. So next, I'm going to attach the speaker. Just clicks in, like we did during the test. Get these wires tucked away, hopefully nicely, without bending them too much. And I'm going to put the infrared little blocker thing. So the original Game Boy Color had an infrared port up at the top, up here, and that was for basically the same thing as the link cable. But the FPGBC doesn't have any components for that, so they just have a piece of plastic that looks like it's an infrared port, I guess. All right, now we're gonna have to put the other side of the shell on. My shell came with the little metal battery springs, so you're gonna have to take those out. And the easiest way I've found to do that is to use a flathead screwdriver that's small enough and go from the inside. There's a little slot and you stick it in there, and you're trying to get a little metal finger to disengage, and then it'll just pop right out. So here, you can see that there. That's what was holding it, holding the battery spring in place. Now, we can put the case on the back. Should slip right on. And screw it in. Let's get some screws in. Now, I don't have the right screwdriver bit for these dry wing screws. I'm just going to use a flathead driver and make it work. It's not ideal. Could end up stripping the top of these screws, but just be careful or buy the right tool. Don't be like me, because it's certainly not the most pleasant thing to do with the flathead. Okay, now I can put the rest of the screws in. There's 6 screws in total that go on the outside. 2 at the top, 2 here at the middle, and 2 in the battery compartment. Okay. Now, next thing I'm going to do is put the screen on. Could have done this first, but it's a little bit easier to do it like this, at least for the first time you do it. Plug it in. Get the little thing clipped down. Now this has adhesive double-sided tape. I'm not going to take it off just yet because I want to make sure everything works. But the screen just slides in like this, nice and easily. All right, now the last thing is the battery. There's a nice little cutout in here. You can get the battery. It's a little bit easier with the tool. Make sure you're not using metal for this though. I'm using the plastic end of this driver. And then just press it in. I think that's good. And then fit the battery into the battery compartment. Whatever it's supposed to be, I don't know. That seems fine. Put the battery cover on. Whoopsie! Probably should tape that in. Gonna end up breaking the screen. Alright, now. Let's see if it works.
Looks like it does.
Cool. So, seems to be working. Let's have a little look at this. Wasn't sure about the red and the color of the pads together, but I kind of like it. I don't know. So on the side here, we have the link cable port. We have the volume. The volume's a rocker instead of a wheel, but it also is a button. And if you press it, it brings up the on-screen display, and you can go and change things. So, for example, you can change the display mode. Right now it's set to times 4, and that does that should be a pixel-perfect scaling of the original Game Boy pixels. You can also put it with a pixel grid to make it look a little bit more like a Game Boy Color, but it does reduce the overall apparent brightness of the screen. Or, if you want more picture, you can go to full screen, and it makes everything a little bit bigger, but maybe you'll notice some scaling artifacts. Next is a core. So since this is a FPGA-based device, you can change what device it's pretending to be. Right now it's set to a Game Boy Color. You can change it to be a Game Boy, and you have to go down to the bottom, click Save. You can either turn it off or go up and press Reset. And now it's a Game Boy. And in the Game Boy mode, you can change the palettes to make it look like just different colors. I like the kind of green, classic Game Boy green. And the next thing is frame mix. That's for some games that take advantage of the limitations of the Game Boy hardware. The original Game Boy screen and the Game Boy Color screen weren't particularly good, and when you update images very quickly, they kind of bleed between the two frames. So you could take advantage of that to get a kind of transparent effect. Not really noticeable on this. I'll just keep it on. And the last setting, well, there's two more settings. There's the GB color fix. I'll switch that back to the Game Boy Color core, and I'll switch to Pokemon. Thank you. So here, if you turn the GB color fix off, you can see that the sprite gets a little bit messed up. Let's see. So I don't really know what exactly that's about, but you can turn it on. The other thing is a speed control. You can speed things up or slow them down, and the game will run a bit slower. My understanding is the FPGBC isn't exactly perfect on its timing, but you can get pretty close. And one other thing, as you can see, I'm on version 1.04, and this can be actually updated. So let's do that now. Nice thing is, it's USB-C, so you can just plug that straight into your computer and turn it on. It'll show up on your screen as just like a USB storage device. And let's turn that sound off. And you can go to the Funny Playing website on the FPGBC page, and there are some downloads. And you want to download the latest one. So right now it's 1.06. And let me download that and click download and open it up. So we want to just copy the update.bin over to the Funny Playing device. Let that finish. And then it should just restart. And we can eject it and unplug. Now we can see that it's 1.06. So one other thing I want to try is I have the Easy Flash Junior, and my understanding is this does not work. Yep, it does not work. Micro SD initial error. So, I think some flash carts do work, but not the Easy Flash Junior. This cart is a cart from Inside Gadgets, and that you need a separate programmer. It takes one game at a time, and those seem to work fine. Let's see, what about... I have a... This is a reproduction Pokemon Red. If I can open it, let's just double check that that works. Seems to. Yeah, that works. Okay. So yeah, that's the Funny Playing FPGBC. Thanks for coming along with me for this build. Bye.